Hello, everyone. It's a great pleasure and honor to host this post-quantum cryptography summer school here at the Institute for Quantum Computing within the University of Waterloo. So welcome to Waterloo and to IQC. Waterloo is also home to the Center for Applied Cryptographic Research, which is where the initial seeds of IQC were planted, in fact. Alfred Menezes, the founding managing director of the CACR and the general chair of PQCrypto 2014, has done a tremendous job coordinating the execution of these events, and we have record-breaking numbers of participants this year, which is really good. It's very important that we have more and more people joining this field, because we'll need people like you as the world transition to a cryptographic infrastructure that's secure against quantum computers. In fact, here at Waterloo, we've set up a special training program called CryptoWorks 21 to give supplementary training in quantum-safe cryptography to students and postdocs who are working in various aspects of cryptography. And this school is part of that training. In addition to CryptoWorks 21, we have received generous support from the IQC, the Fields Institute, NSF through the Fields Institute, the Perimeter Institute for Theoretical Physics, which many of you have probably seen as it's close to the hotel, the Tut Institute for Mathematics and Computing in Ottawa, and Microsoft Research. I was personally very delighted that the speakers we have for this school accepted to come here, and I'm sure we all look forward to their lectures. It's a pleasure and honor now for me to introduce our first speaker, Professor Johannes Buchmann, who has been one of the driving forces behind building the post-quantum cryptography community in so many different ways. His own research, his training of so many other leaders in the field, his book, his leadership in the organization of the PQ Crypto workshops, in industry and government outreach, and more. He's going to kick off the school with a lecture on hash-based signatures. Before I call up Professor Buchmann, I'll also introduce the second speaker of the first session, which is Dr. Andreas Hulsing. Dr. Hulsing used to work at the Fraunhofer Institute for Secure Information Technology in Darmstadt, Germany, before completing a PhD in post-quantum cryptography with Professor Buchmann at Darmstadt. And he's now a postdoctoral researcher at TU Eindhoven, working on post-quantum signature schemes. It's a pleasure to have both of them here today to teach us about digital signatures in a quantum era. Thanks very much.
And okay, can you hear me? Yeah. Okay, so it's a pleasure for me to speak here. Thanks for inviting me. I will give the introductory part to the hash-based signature lecture. The real expert, Andreas, is speaking after me, introducing you to the technical details. So, as Michele said, I was involved in post-quantum cryptography for some time. I personally find this is a very important subject. In the first part, I would like to explain to you why this is true. And I'm very happy that so many of you came here to listen to this, and I expect this topic to become more important in the future. We also have this workshop of the standardization body ETSI in the following week in Ottawa, from which you can see that post-quantum cryptography is already of practical importance. So people are looking at this from a practical point of view. Okay, so let me start. How do you say this? Carrying olds to Athens? So, yeah, do you have this saying? No. Eulen nach Athen tragen. What is this in English? Ah, so you have an English version of this. Anyway, so you all probably know about digital signatures. So I will start, so to speak, slowly, if I can, which I cannot. Wait. Yeah, good. So digital signatures, you probably know all about digital signatures. Just briefly, you have a document, then you have a sign algorithm. The sign algorithm receives as input the document and the secret key, signature key. The result is a signature. And then there's a verification algorithm. And the verification algorithm receives the corresponding verification key. And the output is valid or invalid. You all know this, right? Now, digital signatures are very important because they can achieve several important security goals. Typically, in cryptography, we think about the security goal confidentiality, which digital signatures obviously cannot achieve. But another important security goal is integrity. Prove that a document has not been changed. Authenticity. Prove that the document has not been changed and verify the origin. Non-repudiation. The origin cannot be denied by the person who is, or by the entity who is the origin. And these all are very important security goals. I find that they may be even more important than confidentiality, because whenever confidentiality is required, integrity must be proved. Typically, also authenticity must be proved. Not non-repudiation, that is a different thing. But a confidentiality without integrity, without authenticity, is no good. But there is many applications in which you need integrity proof, authenticity proof, but no confidentiality. So what I claim is that there is no IT security without digital signatures, and you have, many of you or the people who are in the community, I have shown this example many times, but I find it very important, so I would like to repeat it here. Think about software updates. So in many applications, this is Firefox. You are asked whether you would like to permit the computer to automatically look for updates. So Firefox is automatically updated. I've checked the box. Add-ons are automatically updated. I checked the box. Search engines also. And the What I am allowing the computer to do is automatically download and install the updates and warn me if this will disable any of my add-ons. Just soon. Okay. The question, of course, is, and this is an example for the relevance of authenticity. Is the update authentic, or in the background do you get this update? Now, if you look at this update, you will probably be easily able to say what it does. So some people are laughing. I mean, I think you are also probably all familiar with this. So what it does, it deletes the hard disk of the computer. Now, you cannot see which update you really get, right? I mean, something is happening in the background. And this, I mean, you cannot check whether this update is sent to you and it is executed. And imagine that all Firefox users get this update, all of them. There is many. So this is a serious issue. And we just show you a few pictures where automatic update. It's not just about computers. It's also about other devices. So it's about smartphones, tablets, cars. There's a lot of software in cars now. And I hear from BMW that they are now connecting all BMWs in, at least in North America. In Europe, they are a little bit more sensitive with respect to privacy. But in North America, they will all connect them to the internet, and they will all update them automatically. I mean, they will check for them, and then you can call them, or you send them email and say, I have a problem with my BMW. They log onto your thing, and then they say, oh, you have a software problem, and they automatically upload some update. Okay. Now, this is an important application, not the only one, but a very important application of digital signatures. Digital signatures protect from malicious updates. This is done by code signing, which works as follows. Suppose that Apple wants to publish some software update. Now, Apple has a secret signing key and signs the update digitally. The result is the digitally signed update. It sends this update to the user. The user uses her public key. In case that the signature cannot be validated, it is put in the trash can, this update. Otherwise, it is used. Very simple, right? But you can see that the digital signature is supposed to guarantee that this update is authentic and is from Apple or from Firefox or from whoever. And everybody is using this. So the question is, what about the signature schemes being used today? Now, in fact, this is the most popular signature scheme. The signature scheme from the year 1978, of course, with its modifications over time. This is the original paper, A Method for Obtaining Digital Signatures and Public Key Crypto Systems by Rivest, Chami, and Edelman, the famous RSA scheme. Okay, I would like to explain to you what security assumption it relies on, which will be very important in this lecture. I would like to explain to you a generic version of RSA. Now, from a generic point of view, the public verification key is a finite group G, and we will come to the concrete group in a minute, but just think about a finite group for the moment. Some exponent E with the property that the GCD of this exponent, it will be the verification exponent, and the group order is 1. You will see in a minute why this is true. The secret key, and this is the interesting fact, is the group order. So what we need is a group in which you can compute without revealing the group order, in which everybody can compute and the group order is kept secret. Now, the reason for the exponent being coprime to the group order is that such an exponent E allows to compute eth roots in the group when the group order is known. This is done as follows. The eth root of a group element is obtained by raising the group element to the inverse of the exponent E modulo the group order. You can see, in order to know what the inverse is, you have to know what the group order is. So the interesting fact is that Everybody can compute in the group, so everybody can raise elements to ETH orders, but only those who know the secret can extract ETH roots. So you also need a hash function in order, we want to sign arbitrarily long documents, so you need a hash function which maps messages to group elements. Okay, now how does the signature work? Well, if you have such a generic setting, remember, extracting ETH roots can only be done by the person or the entity who has the secret group order. Raising to ETH powers can be done by everybody. So now we need to do something. I mean, signing is doing something that only the entity can do that knows the secret. Well, so what does the entity do? The entity extracts the ETH root of the hash of the document and uses the verification key, which is the group order. Simple. Right? Well, this is like. And the signature is the ETH root. Okay, now the question is, how do we verify this? Now, if you want to verify that an element S in the group is the ETH root of the hash of the document, well, then you raise the element to the ETH power, which everybody can do. So raise S to the ETH power and check whether it's the hash of the document. So this is, in principle, what RSA does. And then, depending on whether this is true or not, you get valid or invalid. By the way, if you have any questions, just interrupt me and ask them. Now, you may not have seen this presentation of RSA, but I find it interesting to look at RSA from this point of view, because you see that the crucial point is coming up with a group in which you can compute and can keep the group order secret. It's not so trivial. Well, and as you know, the group that Rives, Chamir, and Edelman were using is the following. You take your exponent E, you take two prime numbers P and Q, which are large, you take the product N, which is P times Q, and then the group is the group of residues, the multiplicative group of residues modulo N. And now you can immediately verify that everybody can compute in this group who knows N, because the only thing that you need to do is you need to compute modulo N. But what's the group order? The group order is P minus 1 times Q minus 1. So if you know P and Q, then you know the group order. And it can be shown that whoever knows the group order P minus 1 times Q minus 1, this is an easy exercise, can also find out, if you know N and if you know P minus 1 times Q minus 1, you can find out about P and Q. So knowing the group order requires the knowledge of the factors, but computing in the group requires the knowledge of the composite N. And the interesting thing also is that this is pretty much the only way, the only group that is known in which everybody can compute and the group order can be kept secret. There's variants of this with elliptic curve groups, but in contrast to the discrete log problem, which you probably also know, and there's lots of groups where computing discrete logarithms in the group is difficult and the groups are different, this is, to my knowledge, the only group in which you can do this. So this is RSA, pretty much raising to powers. Everybody can do this verification, extracting roots, signing. Group is the group of residue multiplicative, the multiplicative group of residues modulo. There's other digital signature schemes, which I will not explain. There's the Algamal scheme, which was standardized as a variant, is standardized in 1994 as the DSA scheme. There is the elliptic curve discrete digital signature algorithm, which was invented in 1985 and standardized in 2005. invented by Koblitz and Miller. Okay, now let's look. Okay, which schemes are used in practice? Okay, so we collected a number of, we looked at applications. Of course, one of the important applications of software updates is obviously virus scanners, malware scanners, because you have to update them on a daily basis. Kaspersky, Norton. And you see what they do? They sign. So the hash is SHA-1 RSA 2048. Then SHA-1 RSA 1024, RSA 1024, RSA 2048, Adobe, RSA 2048, Google, RSA 2048, Mozilla, RSA 2048, Apple, RSA 2048. There's one exception that we know. There's a number of other. I think the number of applications of elliptic curve cryptography is growing, but the majority of applications in this context is RSA. This is the PlayStation 3. I don't know whether anybody still uses PlayStation 3.
And they didn't implement it right.
Oh, okay. So they made a mistake in implementing it even. Anyway, so what we see is this. So we see that digital signatures are very important, and on the other side, we see that everybody uses RSA pretty much. So the question is, how secure are the digital signature schemes that we use today? Okay, if you analyze this, then you see we have two assumptions. The first assumption is that we have a so-called trapdoor one-way function, and the second assumption is that we have a secure hash function. And those two assumptions are being used to make this digital signature scheme secure. So let me show you this in the example that I have explained. And the question is, where is the hash function? You see it, and where is the trapdoor one-way function? Well, let's look at the hash function first. So security of the hash function, which in our case maps documents to group elements. So we have on the one side messages. Our message D is mapped to a group element Y. And the important thing is that you must not be able to find, nobody must be able to find a collision. What is a collision? A second element that maps to the same group element. So we don't want this. Why? Well, easy, right? So if you have a second element that maps to the same group element, then you have signatures for both documents, because the ETH roots of one hash is the ETH roots of the other hash, because they are equal anyway, right? So we must not, I mean, of course, hash functions have many collisions. I mean, really, I mean, there's really, really many collisions, but still, and this is sounds like a little bit paradoxical, but still you must not be able to find such a collision. So this is required. And as you can see, there is a number of hash functions that, to the best of our knowledge, do this. We have a list here. So coming up with hash functions seems to be doable. Okay, trapdoor, what is the trapdoor function? Okay, so we have a domain, which is the group, and we have the images are also group elements. And the trapdoor function is raising elements to the eth power. And trapdoor one-way function have the property, as long as you don't know a secret, you cannot invert this thing. So you cannot extract eth roots unless you know the secret. It is interesting to, sometimes we discuss the question why this is called trapdoor. right? If you think about this physically, I mean, why is this a trapdoor? This is something I don't know. I mean, I don't understand, anyway, you can think about it for a second. Why is this a trapdoor? Anyway, so you, those who know the secret kind of go into the trap. Well, what can we say? Maybe you want to discuss this in the break. Anyway, so those who know the secret can invert it. And it turns out that this is very difficult to, and it's much more difficult to come up with trapdoor one-way functions than with hash functions. And we need both here. So the RSA trapdoor one-way function, as I explained to you, relies on the hardness of factoring. I have given you, I mean, this is, I'm not sure whether this is still true. This is kind of, anyway, so this is a composite modulus, which either is now or has been used by Microsoft to sign their updates. It has 617 decimal digits. So if you can factor this number, you can send, or maybe in the past, you may have to find the more recent thing, but then you can send your favorite friends your update that you like. Right? So this is all. This is why I show this number. This is what the security of updates relies on, such a number. And there are lots of these numbers around. And if you can factor them, you can send updates. Okay? So we must make sure that it is hard to factor integers. Now, here is the factorization progress. And you see, I mean, these are the Fermat numbers. I don't want to talk about it's an interesting, but I don't have too much time, so I don't want to talk about Fermat numbers. For those of you who know what they are, you see when they were factored, so they, and a Fermat number is 2 to the 2 to the nth Fermat number is 2 to the 2 to the n plus 1, and you can see that in the year 1970, the seventh Fermat number was factored for the first time, and it was 39 decimal digits. Before, they could not factor it. 39 decimal digits. They needed computers to do this. And then the eighth Fermat number in 1980, the ninth Fermat number in 1990, that shows there is some progress. The number of digits approximately doubles with each increment of the index. So this picture basically shows you that there is progress in factoring. It is not that factoring is difficult and this is it. There's researchers who work on this. And the reason why we are here is this paper it was published in 97. I think the algorithm was invented in 94. And it is this polynomial time algorithm for prime factorization and discrete logarithms on a quantum computer. This shows that factoring can be done in polynomial time on a sufficiently large and practical quantum computer. So this is the reason why we are here. And this is, now you have the situation that on the one side, signatures, which in our application means software updates, rely on the hardness of factoring, and quantum computers can do this. This is why we are interested in this. Now the question is, are quantum computers realistic? And in 2012, I mean, you look. There's even a Wikipedia site where you can see the progress of quantum computing. So, for example, IBM makes experiments and. This is a quote, optimism about superconducting qubits and the possibility for a future quantum computer are rapidly growing. And we are in a building where they're doing it. I mean, this building is devoted in part to showing that this is really possible. So this is not science fiction. I mean, maybe a little bit, but okay. So what do we do? Okay, so this is, so 10 years ago, when we started to look into post-quantum cryptography, we thought what we should do is we should look at the Merkle signature scheme as a variant. Okay? So what we need to do is find the signature schemes independent of factoring discrete logarithm. And interestingly, in 1997, Ralph Merkle, so this was approximately at the same time as the RSA scheme was invented, the Merkle signature scheme, and the paper is called The Certified Digital Signature by Ralph Merkle, and you see his picture here when he was still younger. Okay, so how does it work? It is amazingly simple, and this is an interesting question why nobody used it, but it is at the end of my part, I will give you the reasons why this was not used, and then Andreas will explain to you why it can be used now from our point of view. And now, we will talk about this also next week. There is an IETF standard draft for hash-based signatures. So people are really looking into this as a practical thing. Okay. So what it basically does, it takes the so-called Lamport-Diffie one-time signature scheme. One-time means one signature key and verification key per document, per signature. And the second step is it uses a hash tree to reduce the value. This is kind of bad because you need many, many, many verification keys. So it uses a hash tree to reduce the validity of many verification keys to one public key, which is the root of the tree. And the interesting fact is, you will see this, the Merkle scheme does not require one-way trapdoor functions, only secure hash functions. And I explained to you that it appears to be much easier to find secure hash functions. You will hear in this summer school about many other approaches where people construct trapdoor one-way functions. I find it is much more difficult, and therefore we should really look at this hash-based situation. Okay, now I will just explain this to you in an example. So the Lambert-Diffie one-time signature scheme works as follows. So here's the key generation step. So what you need to do is we want to sign bit strings of length 3. This is not secure, it's just an example. Bit strings of length 3. For each position, we select a random string, two random strings. One random string will be for the first position to be 0, the second random string will be for the first position to be 1, and so forth. So these are random strings of length 3. Here they are. We use our hash function, which in our case is not only used as a one-way function, to map these strings to their images. So you see that, for example, the first string 010, which is for the first bit when it is 0, is mapped to 011. Likewise, the second string 110 is mapped to 111, and so forth, okay? So this is the verification key. So the signing key is the secret strings, the verification key is the sequence of images. Okay? So now we have these the keys, and we would like to sign hello world. What we do is we map it to its hash, and now the hashes are of length 3, and we say that we assume that the hash is 010. So the first step is hashing. The second step is now we need to sign 010. And we need to use the secret signature key for this. Now, how do we do it? This is the signature. What is the construction principle for those who have never seen it? So the construction principle is to publish part of the signature key. If the first bit is zero, you publish the string that corresponds to zero. And you see that the string that corresponds to zero is 010. So you must, so the first string in the signature is 010. Now the second bit in the hash of the to be signed message is one. And you see that there's two strings for signing the second position, namely, one, this string is for, if the first string happens to be zero, as the second string happens to be zero, and this string is, the second string happens to be one. So what we must do is we must select 0, 1, 0, 1, because the second position is one, so it's 0, 0, 1. And likewise, the third position is zero. So here are the two strings that are, this is for zero, this is for one, so you select 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. This is the signature. So you publish, and you can immediately see this is a one-time signature scheme. You can only do this once, because then afterwards it's public. I mean, this part of it is public. And now the verification. Well, the verifier applies the, first of all, applies the hash to the signature. And the hash function is public, so you can do this. And then the verifier, she hashes the document and finds that it is 010. And then the verifier knows the public verification key, so she puts a, so she knows that if everything is correct, then this string should map to this string. So she puts the corresponding strings here. You can see this is 011 because this is a 0, this is 010010 because this is a 1, and so forth, and then she checks. I mean, this is all. And you can see it is not possible to make up signatures yourself because these are hash functions, and as secure hash functions, they're also one way, and you cannot invert this. Okay? And the Merkel signature scheme, so now we are in the position that it's a very simple signature scheme that just uses, well, in fact, it only uses a one-way function. We use the hash function as a one-way function only. So we immediately get rid of the necessity for using a one-way trapdoor function. It's not needed, right? And now you can think of all the hash functions that I've shown to you that you can use. So you have lots and lots of instantiations of the scheme, and Merkel says, this is nice, but it is kind of bad that we have all these verification keys. So if we want to, for example, sign 2 to the 40 messages, we need to store 2 to the 40 verification keys. No good. So this is why Merkel said, why don't we do this? Now, say we want to sign 2 to the H documents. So we select a tree height, which is h. Then we generate 2 to the h. In this case, h is 3. 2 to the h pairs of one-way, one-time signature keys. We use the verification keys and apply the hash function. We get hashes. We concatenate the first two hashes and apply the hash function again. So the principle is the parent in the tree is the hash of the concatenation of its children. In this way, we construct the Merkel tree, which you are maybe also familiar with, and we get a root, and the root is the public key. Now, if you want to sign, you do this. Here is a document to be signed. Now we go through the key pairs one by one. We know, as a signer, we know all the secret signature keys. So suppose we are using the ICE signature key. So we use it. Of course, the verifier does not know the verification key because he only knows the public key, which is the root of the tree. So what the verifier does is sorry, what the signer does is, the signer includes the number I, the document signature that he just produced with the ith signature key, and the ith verification key in the signature. And then he also includes a sequence of nodes in the tree that allows the verifier, sorry, to construct the path from this leaf, which corresponds to this verification key, to the root. And verifying, well, the verifier gets this signature, and the verifier knows the public key. She first checks whether this verification with the provided verification key works, and then she constructs the path from the leaf to the root and checks whether the root that she obtains is the verification, is the public key. This Merkle. Very simple. Why does it not? Is it not sufficient? Well, the public key generation time is very big because the tree can become very big. Private key size is very big because the private key still consists of all the one-time keys. The signature size is pretty big because you have this, it is quadratic. It turns out to be quadratic in the security parameter. And then this authentication path generation is not clear how to do it, and you really have to do this optimally. And this is a question of time and space. And finally, is there any proofs? So this is where we started off a number of years ago. And this is where Andreas will now take over. It was his thesis that contributed a lot. There's a number of theses before contributed something. So listen to the person who invented much of this stuff. Oh, you need a microphone, sorry.
So can you hear me? Lots in the back? Okay, so before I go into the details, I will first introduce or give a big overview over the scheme that we developed, and we call the scheme XMSS. And as Professor Buchmann just said, so that was kind of a long project where several PhD theses contributed, and people involved are Professor Buchmann, Carlos Coronado, Eric Dahmen, and myself. And there was a whole bunch of works published on the stuff. And the project ran about 7 years, so yeah. So we managed to do some things. The first thing is for the security, if we've got a security parameter n, we require two families of functions. The first one is a length-preserving family of functions, which maps n-bit strings using n-bit keys to n-bit outputs. And the second one is a family of functions where each function maps two n-bit strings to an n-bit string using also function keys of length n. But for these ones, we will in practice simply consider it is some hash function where the key is hard-coded and don't care about this anymore. And then we can show that XMSS is existentially unforgeable under adaptive chosen message attacks. So that's kind of the standard security notion for signature schemes. If the first function family, the length preserving one, is pseudo-random, and the second one is second pre-image resistant. So I will not explain these properties in detail. For those of you that don't know, it's a pseudo-randomness. It's kind of like you cannot distinguish a randomly chosen element from the function family from some completely random function. And second pre-image resistance simply says if you're given an element of the domain, it's hard to find a second element of the domain such that these two values collide. The second thing is XMSS uses a slightly improved one-time signature scheme called the Winternet's OTS. And this has certain benefits. So if you look at these signature in the Merkle scheme, then we can observe that the one-time public key included is roughly as big as the one-time signature with the straightforward optimization. So you actually only have to include those nodes of the public key in the overall signature, which are not included in the one-time signature if you use Lampert-Diffie. And so these two elements are m times as big as the authentication path nodes if we consider that we use that we sign an mbit message or an mbit hash value normally. Now, Winternet's OTS gives us two optimizations. The first thing is the public key can be computed as a function of the one-time signature, and hence we can delay the verification of the one-time signature to the verification of the root of the tree. So we do not have to include the one-time public key anymore. We simply compute a public key, one-time public key given the one-time signature, and then check if this one-time public key is authenticated by the tree. The second thing we can do is there's some trade-off between runtime and signature size. So we can roughly reduce the one-time signature size by a factor of log W, where W is the Winternet's parameter, which controls this trade-off. And so we can further shrink this second big element in the Merkle signature. So this already gives us quite some improvement in the signature size. For the secret key, we use some pseudo-random key generation. So if you look at the basic Merkle signature scheme, then we have a secret key size of two times the security level that we want to reach times the message length, so which will be normally something like the hash output, 256 bits, times the number of one-time signature keys in the tree, which is 2 to the h if we have a tree of height h. Now, for XMSS, we generate all these one-time signature secret keys using the pseudo-random function family f. And thereby, we can reduce the secret key to a single seed, and so only need to store B bits. And also get the secret key size independent of the message length that we want to sign. But a short spoiler, so actually, this is not the secret key size that we will get out in the end, because you also have to store some additional public information which is needed in both cases to speed up the computation of signatures. Then for the public key generation, so as Professor Buchmann just said, these trees get quite large. And for the Merkle signature scheme, we have to generate a tree of size 2 to the h. And so we get something which is exponential, or yeah, in the end, it's linear in the number of signatures that you can do. So we get cos of 2 to the h. For XMSS, we use something called tree chaining. The idea is roughly that you use many layers of trees, and the trees on the higher levels are used to sign the roots of the trees on the lower levels. And if we use T such layers of trees, each of height H over T, then we still get a signature scheme that can sign 2 to the H messages. but we only have to generate the T first trees on each, so the first tree on each layer, which gives T trees of height 2 to the H over 2 during this, the key generation. And so we can get down to T times 2 to the H over T, which is roughly the T-th root of the previous key generation time. So for example, if we want to sign 2 to the 40 messages with the key pair, then we would have to spend something like 2 to the 40 hash function calls, a bit more for the traditional scheme, and in the tree chaining case for XMSS, 2 to the 21. However, we slightly have to pay for this with an increased signature size. So if we look at the signature size, now only for one level, then if we consider a security level of B bits, a tree height of H, and a message length of M bits, then the Merkle signature can be split into the following parts. So the index will be of, will have H bits, because we have to encode 2 to the H numbers up to 2 to the H minus 1. The one-time public key will be 2 times the bit security times the message length. For Lamport-Diffie, the signature will be B times the message length. And we've got H authentication path nodes, each of them having 2 times B bits, because for the Merkle signature scheme, we need in the tree a collision-resistant hash function to get a security proof. And this sums up to H times 2 times the security level plus 1, plus 3 times B times M. And for XMSS, the first thing we do, which I will not explain in more detail, is we modify the tree construction. So it's a pretty simple trick. We introduce bit masks, masking the input to the hash function every time we compute a parent node. And this slight change allows us to reduce the security requirement in the tree from collision resistance to second pre-image resistance. For those of you who are familiar with the reductionist proofs, it simply allows you to put a second pre-image challenge in a certain position that you sampled at random, and then you can later extract a second pre-image. And hence, we do not need 2 B-bit nodes, but only B-bit nodes. Oops, shouldn't be an N there. So we get this first reduction for the authentication path part. And then using the Winternet scheme, as I explained before, we get a second reduction in the one-time signature part. So we don't need the one-time public key. We get a smaller one-time signature. And so in total, the first summand is reduced by a factor of 2. And the second summand is reduced by a factor of 3 log W, which in practice is quite a lot, as you will see at the very end of this talk. For the authentication path computation, if you take a naive approach to compute these authentication paths, then you either, for every signature, have to compute 2 to the H nodes and 2 to the H leaves, or you have to store 2 to the H nodes. And as H is growing, because you want to sign more messages, this soon gets quite large, and I will give you numbers for what happens if you try to do this later on. And what we use, and what I will also explain later, is an algorithm developed by Buchmann, Darmen, and Schneider. And this algorithm allows a time-memory trade-off, which is controlled by some parameter k. And it reduces the worst case runtime per signature to h minus k over 2 one-time signature computations and a small amount of hash function computations. And for this, it needs memory of 5.5 times h times minus 5k minus 2k, actually times the bit security, which I omitted here for some case. So that's what I mentioned in the spoiler. So that's some public state that we have to store in addition to the secret key to make the computations for the signature, per signature efficient. So, I'm sorry, I had to split up the slides because otherwise PowerPoint kills me. Nope. So, now we start with a bit more detailed things. First, I want to talk about the one-time signatures. So as I said, we use the WinterNet's one-time signature scheme, and that's what I was working a lot on. This scheme is quite old. It was already mentioned in Merkel's first work, where he proposed this tree-based signature schemes, and was due to some idea that he was given by WinterNet's. The first full description that I'm aware of is by Evan et al. In the Journal of Cryptology from 96. Then there were two works considering proofs for these schemes, one by Hevia and Michancho and one by Dotz et al. And this second paper actually focused on WinterNets. The other one focused on a more abstract generic class of one-time signature schemes. And so the best result that they achieved was that the WinterNet's one-time signature scheme is secure if the used function is collision-resistant, undetectable, one-way function family. And during the last years, we improved on these results. On the one hand, we introduced a slight tweak in the construction. So if you do it a bit different, then you can get a security proof from pseudorandom function families. And if you do another tweak, then you can get a security reduction from second preimage resistant undetectable one-way function families. And I will explain the constructions later. So, short recap, Professor Buchmann just explained the Lamport-Diffie scheme. So we've got a message consisting of m bits, and we've got a one-way function h. And now for key generation, we sample 2m random n-bit blocks. And to obtain a public key, we simply feed each of these blocks to the one-time hash function. And this gives us the public key. And actually, these are always pairs of pairs. So the secret key consists of pairs of secret key elements, which are used to sign a 0 or to sign a 1. And they've got a corresponding pair in the public key. And now you simply got something like a multiplexer that, given the message bits, selects one of the secret key entries. So that's what you just saw before. Now you can do some trivial optimization. The first one is what I briefly mentioned. If you need the signature and the public key together, then you can always select from each of these pairs one secret key element and one public key element. Because in the end, you can compute the second public key element from the signature element that you were given, and then you've got your you've got the whole public key in the end when verifying the signature. Is this clear for everyone? Okay. There's another non-trivial optimization, and it's based on the following observation. So now we've still got the same secret key size, but I numbered it differently. We still got the same public key. But now I move these selections of the public key to the end. So the first, the encoded message now consists of first all the message bits, and then the inverted message bits. And then you get roughly the same one-time signature scheme, but only reordered. So the signature always consists, if a bit is one, then you get the secret key element. And otherwise, you get the public key element, so the hash of the secret key. So the previous one would have been always an encoding B1, not B1, B2, not B2. And now I move these not BI to the end. And if you look at this, this is simply some checksum with a very bad performance, because you simply encode the whole mess, take a checksum of the whole message length. And you can do better than this. And the modification is quite simple. So this time we only need M plus log M secret key elements. And instead of appending these inverted message bits at the end, we append a checksum that consists of the Hamming weight. So we sum up over all the bits of the message. And then we bitwise invert the Hamming weight. And this checksum has the simple property that if one of the bits BI is flipped from 1 to 0, then another bit will flip from 0 to 1. And this is quite important, because if someone wants to forge a signature, is already knowing one signature, of course, he could always flip a message bit from 1 to 0, then he would only have to include the public key, and that's something he knows. Now, that's actually where the checksum helps us, because if he flips one of the message bits from 1 to 0, so that he would only have to include the public key, he's forced to include a secret key element, so a pre-image of a value that he knows in some other position. And that's kind of a basic idea that is also extended for the WinterNet scheme. So for the WinterNet scheme, an additional optimization comes in, which is the use of function chains or of iterated hash functions. So if we got our function family, which is length preserving, then the basic construction was simply iteratively apply the hash function. So to build a function chain, we've got some chaining function ci of x, and to compute the ith element of this chain starting from x, we apply the hash function I times. And applying the hash function 0 times, so the zeros element is simply the identity, so x itself. Now, I will explain it with the most complicated construction, because given this, it's easy to explain the other ones. So for WOTS plus, the chaining works a bit differently. So in addition to a function key k, which is used then to select the element from the function family, we have to sample W minus 1 randomization elements. And then we build the function chain the following way. So it's a recursive function. And if you're given the output of the last iteration, then you first XOR the randomization element corresponding to the current iteration, apply the hash function, and get the new output. Shouldn't be too hard. And thereby, we can build a hash chain of length W minus 1, or would start and end, it has length W. And so two different constructions for this. As I told you, the basic construction is simply iterating I times the hash function. Then for this WOTS construction, where we get security from the pseudo-randomness of the function family, we slightly change this iteration function. So in that case, the output of the last iteration is used as the function key for the next iteration. So instead of like a random walk through the domain, in this case, we do a random walk through the function family and select a new function with each iteration. And WOTS plus is exactly what I explained to you before. So XORing a randomization element and then applying the hash function. OK, so now how does the scheme work given these kind of function chains? Key generation works as follows. We take a Winternitz parameter W, which determines the chain length. Then we take a security parameter N, a message length M. So we assign M bit messages and our function family that maps M bit strings to N bit strings using an N bit key. Then we first compute L, and L is the length of the message together with the checksum. And you will see in the next slide an idea how it is computed, and the formula doesn't tell you much, but it roughly simply covers the message encoding. Then we sample a function key K and the randomization elements, or depending on which chain construction we use, the information needed to compute the chain. Then our secret key consists of L random n-bit strings, which are sampled like for the Lamport-Diffie scheme in the beginning. And then we compute the public key as the end node of W minus one iterations of the function chain. Okay, so we have these nodes, and instead of doing one hash, we now do this bit more complicated iteration function W minus one times, giving us L chains of length W. Now, how do I sign with this? In the beginning, I get a message M consisting of M bits. And the first thing I do is I represent this message as base W numbers. So I split it into single blocks of numbers ranging from 0 to W minus 1. The second thing I do is I compute a checksum quite similar to the one that I explained for the optimized Lamport-Diffie, which gives us kind of the same properties, but which I will not detail today. And we encode this checksum again as base W numbers and append it. And the result are L base W numbers. So if you think of W equals 8, which is quite frequently used, then these are simply 3-bit entries each. Now, given these numbers and our kind of virtual secret key structure, then we do the following. We select, use the first element to select the B1th element of the first function chain. And we do this for all function chains. So in the end, we select the BLth element from the Lth function chain. So the chain starting from secret key value SKL. And this together gives us the signature. Does someone have an idea how such a signature can be verified? Okay, not so interactive then. So the verifier knows the message, he knows the function family and N, he knows the Winternitz parameter, and he knows how the chaining function is computed. So first, he can recompute this base W block because there's no secret information involved. It's merely the message. The next thing he's got is the signature. And now, because he knows the BI, he can decide as which iteration of the chain these sigma I have to be interpreted. And he can simply finish the function chains up to the end and thereby obtain a public key value. And if this result, okay, more details, but if this resulting output, so applying the function chain W minus 1 minus B1 times for the first chain on sigma 1, if this value equals the given public key value, then the signature is valid. And as I said, for this tree-based signatures, then we can simply use these elements as the public key, which is then verified through the tree. And if the and so we compute the root of the tree. And if this root matches our given public key, then the one-time signature is valid and the whole path. And we get some security proofs for these constructions. So for the basic one, the proof by dots et al. Shows that WOTS is strongly unforgeable under chosen message attacks if the function family is a collision-resistant, undetectable one-way function family. So strong unforgeability gives us a bit more than existential unforgeability, but it's only necessary if we want to use the one-time signature scheme for other constructions like CCA secure encryption schemes. But for the general use in signature schemes, this is not so important for us. For WOTS dollar, which is the one where we do the walk through the function family, we get existential unforgeability under chosen message attacks if the function family is pseudorandom function family. And finally, for WOTS plus, so the one with these randomization elements, we can show that in this case, again, the scheme is strongly unforgeable under chosen message attacks if the function family is a second pre-image resistant, undetectable one-way function family. So, and regarding performance, we get the following. So if we look at Lampert-Diffie, then we've got a public and a secret key size consisting of 2b times m bits, where b is the security level and m is the message length. We get a signature size of b times m bits, and the key generation time is roughly 2 times m hash function evaluations. And the key generation time is actually what is most important for the hash-based signatures, because you will compute these one-time signature keys many times if you want to do it efficiently. For the basic WinterNet scheme, we get a public key size of L times 2B, because we've got L chains, so it's the L end nodes, and as we need collision resistance, we need 2B bits to achieve a security of B bits. The same holds for the secret key and the signature, because it's always one node from each chain. And the key generation time is L times W hash function calls, because we have to build L chains of length W. Now, the key generation time remains the same also for the other constructions, but for the other two constructions, in general, we reduce the secret key and the signature size to L times B bits, because we do not need collision resistance anymore. And these weaker properties give us a higher bit security. The only thing is, in the public key, we have to add some information. So for this WOTS dollar, we need a fixed random value on which we iterate the function family. So there we have to store B bits in addition. And for WOTS plus, we have to store W minus one randomization elements. But if we use these schemes in a tree construction, we can use the same randomization elements for all the one-time signature key pairs. So we really only have to store these bit masks one, or this randomization element once, for all the 2 to the h one-time signature key pairs. OK, I hope I didn't lose you yet. And I think then now we take a short break and meet again in 5 minutes.
Maybe at 20 past.
So yeah, it's completely fine.
Let's meet here again at
Now we did the probably worst theoretical part for many of you, it will now get easier if it was hard to follow before. So the next thing we're looking at is the secret key. So as I told you, we're doing some kind of pseudo-random key generation. And if you look at these parameters that we need, so the function output size, the tree height, h, the witness parameter, w, the message length, m, and this l, which is the number of function chains in the Winternet scheme, then we need to compute 2 to the h Winternet's signature keys for the whole key pair. And each of these signature keys consists of l random bit strings of length n. And for the XMS secret key generation, we only use one random seed of length n bits. And we generate all these Winternet's one-time signature keys using a pseudo-random function family, namely our length-preserving function f. And to give you some idea of f, think of it as AES, for example. So that's actually something we use in practical implementations. And then the key generation works as follows. So in the beginning, we sample this random seed. And this becomes our secret key. Then we apply the pseudorandom function family in a counter mode to first output one seed per one-time signature key pair. So here, for the first one-time signature key pair, we output the first seed. And then we expand this seed using the seed as key for the function family, again, in a counter mode, to get these L and bit strings that we need for the one-time signature key. And we do this for each of the one-time signature keys. So we get a secret key size of B bits. More or less trivial. You can do this a bit more complicated. And then you get something which I personally find a very nice security property, which is called forward security. And I will first explain the security property. So think of a notary that signs documents, so signs contracts over the years. And at some point, a malicious third party, so an attacker, somehow managed to learn the secret key. For example, because this nice guy lost his smart card and was so smart to write down his PIN on the smart card, which I heard happens quite regularly, or he simply stored it unprotected on his computer. There are many scenarios how this can happen. Now, we've got PKIs, which allow us to revoke a secret key, and then we know at which point in time the secret key was attacked. However, consider the attacker doesn't care about revocation and simply starts signing. Now, if you're given a contract with the signature by this notary, you cannot decide, even knowing the revocation date, if the signature was generated by the notary or by the attacker. By simply looking at the signature, you've got no chance to decide this. And so, at this point, we would have to consider all these contracts to be invalid. Of course, there are like organizational means from the field of PKI that solve this problem, but they add overhead, and I will not discuss this stuff. So simply from looking at the signatures, you have to consider all the signatures done so far to be invalid. Now, how does forward security help us here? So if you look at a classical signature scheme, then we've got a key pair consisting of a public and a secret key. This key pair has a certain lifetime, and over the whole lifetime, we've got the same public and secret key. For forward secure signatures, the lifetime of the key pair is split into several time periods, and while the public key remains the same for the whole lifetime of the key pair, the secret key evolves over time. So for each time period, we get a new secret key. And if now, at some point in time, the attacker attacks and manages to learn the secret key of this time period, because all the previous ones have to be deleted. Then forward security tells us that it is impossible or computationally hard for this attacker to produce a valid signature for any of the previous time periods. Okay, so how can this be achieved with XMSS? If you look at this basic key generation algorithm, then we can slightly modify it the following way. So in the beginning, we again sample some seed of B bits. And we use the seed using a forward secure pseudorandom number generator. So this one is also built out of the pseudorandom function family, but it keeps the state and is updating, and it is impossible learning the actual state to go back to previous states or to distinguish outputs based on these previous states. And now after computing this first seed, we delete the old seed and store this one, a secret key, and this one is then used on the one hand to compute the first one-time secret key. On the other hand, it's also used to compute a new seed. The old one is deleted, the new one becomes our new secret key, and so step by step, we go through the seeds and generate these the one-time secret keys. And this is already enough to prove the scheme in the end forward secure. It's too small. Now after this, we've got a small secret key. Something which is still a problem is the signature time. So currently we are at the point that you have to generate the whole tree for each signature, more or less. And there was quite some work done on this. There was a first algorithm proposed by Merkel which describes how to compute the root of a tree with very few space. And then there was a series of works which ended up with this BDS algorithm that I mentioned before, which I will explain now. And all this is still based on this tree hash algorithm, which was introduced by Merkel in the initial paper where he also proposed a tree-based scheme. And tree hash is an algorithm that, given an internal tree level V and an index I, it computes the node on level V with leftmost descendant Li. So for example, if we are given if we're given I equals 2 and V equals 1, then it would compute this node. And where it is still used in plain without any changes is for key generation. There you run tree hash simply with H and 0, and this computes you the root node. Okay, and as an algorithm, it looks as follows. So we iterate over the number of leaves that have to be used, and in each iteration, we compute a new leaf. And then we hash as long as possible upwards, as long as we've got left nodes accompanying this node and along to hash up. Finally, we push the resulting node on some stack and continue the iteration. And in graphics, this looks as follows. So we start with the first leaf, don't have anything else, so we put it on the stack. Then we compute the second leaf. We've got on the stack a node of the same height, so we can hash one up. We compute the next leaf. The stack is, has only a node on a higher level, so we cannot hash. So we push this one to the stack, compute the next leaf. We can hash up and end up at this node. and so on. And so stepwise, we compute the whole tree. And if you look at this state, then you might already see the maximum storage that we need to store between two iterations are h minus 1 hash values, which is quite nice because if you do it in a naive way, you will have to store the whole tree or at least half of the tree at a certain point. OK, what about the efficiency of this algorithm? So for key generation, we know every node has to be computed once. So to get to the root, we have to compute all the leaves, and we have to compute all the hashes in the tree to get this root node. So this algorithm is kind of optimal. And it takes 2 to the h leaf computations and 2 to the h minus 1 node computations. That's simply the number of leaves in the tree and the number of nodes. Now, for a signature, we always have to compute one node on each level smaller than h for the authentication path, because the authentication path will have one node for each of these levels. And hence, the costs are 2 to the h minus 1 leaf computations and 2 to the h minus 1 minus h nodes. The reason is the only thing you don't have to compute are actually the leaf that was used for the signature and the path from this one up to the root. Everything else in the tree has to be computed. So we didn't gain much. But what you can observe already is many nodes are computed many times. So for example, the nodes on level v equals h minus 1 are computed 2 to the h minus 1 times. And this is by far not optimal if we consider keeping a state. And this is one of the points where the BDS algorithm attacks. So the basic motivation is if we don't use any storage, then as I just told you, we have to do 2 to the h minus 1 leaf computations and 2 to the h minus 1 minus h node computations. If we look at XMSS implemented with SHA-2 and a height of 20, this will take 25 minutes on an older i5 processor. So this would mean 25 minutes to generate a signature. That's something you definitely don't want. The other approach would be to store the whole tree. So we have to store 2 to the h times n bits. If we add in our parameters from before, even if we use n equals 128, which is kind of low-level security for this scheme, so we end up with something like 80 bits, considering reduction losses, then we have to store 2 to the 28 bits, which are 32 megabytes. Also something you do not really want. So this would mean a key pair with 32 megabytes plus something negligible. So, and the idea of the BDS algorithm, which comes from previous works also, is to look for a time memory trade-off. So we want to use a state. And if you look at how the authentication paths are used, so we use the leaves from left to right, and hence we can see how these authentication paths evolve. One more. Someone an observation? OK, so the same node in the authentication path is recomputed many times. And what you can observe is that that a node on level v is recomputed for 2 to the v successive paths. So the first simple idea is simply to keep the authentication paths in storage and only renew those nodes which have to be updated for the next authentication path. That's quite simple. We need eight h nodes of storage. and our runtime goes down to approximately H leaf computations and H node computations on average. But the problem is, in the worst case, we still got these 2 to the H minus 1 leaf and 2 to the H minus 1 minus H node computations, because if we go back exactly when you do the transition from here to here, you still have to compute new nodes on each level. And so while on average we get quite a nice runtime, in the worst case, it's still the 25 minutes in the example before. The second observation is when a new left node in the authentication path is needed, its childrens have been part of the previous authentication paths. So we have computed these children before. And if you look at this transition, so we know we will need a new node here in the next step. Then you already see this one is currently in the authentication path. And so for this transition, we can, on the one hand, before we delete this one, we use it to compute that one. And this one has been seen some time before. So actually, it's I minus for this is index I, then it was part of the authentication path the last time at round I minus 1 minus 2 to the V minus 1. Which might not tell you that much, but I can tell you that if you spend h over 2 storage places for storing these right child nodes of left child nodes, then actually you've got enough storage to always keep these nodes for this short time period until you can use them to compute the left nodes. And this means we can compute all the left nodes simply with one hash computations from now on. So we don't have to consider them anymore. Then the third observation is the right child nodes on the higher levels are the most costly or most expensive ones to compute, which is quite obvious. To compute a node on a level V, we have to compute 2 to the V leaves and 2 to the V minus 1 node computations. So as V increases, the costs increase. And so some kind of trivial idea is simply to store the right nodes on the top K levels during key generation and then use them from storage. So that's kind of an easy way. Thereby, we get some additional storage. So 2 to the K minus 2 and bit nodes have to be stored. But the average computations are h minus k leaf nodes plus h minus k node computations. But we still got this worst case running time. Now we've got this minus k here. But as we don't want to choose k too big because it would increase storage again, this is still a problem. And so we come to the last point, which is a distributed computation. And the intuition is the following. So for every second signature, only one leaf computation is required because only the node on the lowest layer changes. Now our average run time is something like h minus k leaf computations and h minus k node computations. So in every second case is quite cheap and the remaining ones are much more expensive. And the idea is simply to use this unused runtime for these cheap cases to do some pre-computations, which allow us then to reduce the runtime for the cases where we would have to change more nodes in the authentication path. And the general focus here is on distributing the computation of leaves, because as you've seen for winternets, we have to compute all these chains, which is much more expensive than doing H hashes up the tree. So we ignore this hashing inside the tree, but only count the number of leaves which are computed. And towards this distribution, we slightly have to change the triage algorithm. So now we split it into a stateful algorithm, which got some initialization phase, where we simply initialize all the variables. And then we've got a tree hash update, which does exactly one round of the basic iteration inside the algorithm. Yeah. And the concept now is to run one tree hash instance per internal tree level up to the bound of h minus k, where we stored all the remaining nodes. And we always start the computation of a new write node on level v as soon as the node that we computed last for this level becomes part of the current authentication path. So we always run only one instance on each level. And which I will not explain today because it's quite complicated, we use some kind of scheduling strategy that guarantees, on the one hand, that these nodes are finished in time. On the other hand, it tells us, so you can do the scheduling in a way that you can use a single stack of H nodes for all these tree hash instances. And then we can achieve to distribute H minus K over 2 updates per signature among all these running tree hash instances, and this will be enough. And that's then also the worst case runtime. So in every step, we have to spend at most h minus k over 2 updates to these tree hash instances. So our worst case runtime goes down from this 2 to the h minus k minus 1 leaf computations and some node computations to h minus k over 2 plus 1 leaf computations. And as additional storage, we need a single stack of size h minus k nodes for all the tree hash instances together, plus one storage place per instance. So each tree hash instance got a separate storage place to store one node. And this in total gives us 2 times h minus k nodes. So summing up, we get a storage requirement of 3h plus these h over 2 nodes that we need for the left node computations, minus 3k, minus 2, plus 2k and bit nodes. And we have to add some additional storage for the forward secure variant, because then we have, so in the forward secure variant, we can from one seed not assess the seed of a one-time signature key pair on an index further away. So we would have to compute all the intermediate seeds. And to do this more efficiently, you can also use some kind of scheduling pre-computing strategy, which needs this amount of storage and also some additional computations. But for the basic runtime, we get a worst case runtime of h minus k over 2 plus 1 leaf computations, and these additional maximal number of node computations if we really have to hash up for most of the nodes. So that's what we can do for the tree generation. I think it's 9. So now for the public key generation, this is the picture Professor Buchmann showed in the beginning. So for the basic Merkle scheme, we would have to compute the whole tree, which requires 2 to the h node and leaf computations in the Merkle tree. And what we do, which I briefly also already discussed, is using tree chaining. So here is an example with 2 levels. It works as follows. So in the beginning, we generate 2 trees, so the upper tree and the leftmost lower tree. And the root node of the upper tree becomes our public key. And we sign the root of the lower tree using the leftmost leaf of the upper tree. And that's our key generation. And this requires 2 times 2 to the h over 2 node and leaf computations in this Merkle tree. Now, how do we do a signature in that case? So, yeah, if we want to sign the ith message, then we use the ith one-time signature key pair to sign the actual message. Put the signature, in case of Lampert-Diffie, together with the public key into the signature and with this index I. Then we add the authentication path for this lower tree. And then we add the whole signature from the upper tree. So we use this one-time signature here that is used to sign the root, together with the public key and the authentication path nodes, which then allow a verifier later to compute this whole thing up. So if you're given such a signature to verify, you first verify the lower one-time signature, then you hash the public key, getting the ith leaf, then you use the authentication path for the lower tree to compute up to the lower root node. Then you verify the signature on this lower root node using this one-time public key. You hash the public key and verify it using the authentication path for the upper tree. Should be kind of understandable now. And in the end, you end up with some root node, and that one you compare to the public key. Now, this can be done more efficiently, and there are some simple ideas, like, for example, you can store these one-time signatures linking higher levels with each other because they are used for many signatures. So you keep them in your local storage as long as they are needed. And you can also start pre-computing upcoming signatures. So while these leaves are here used, we start pre-computing this one-time signature. And we also pre-compute the upcoming root nodes. So during signature generation, while this tree is used, we compute this tree. So every time a leaf on the left tree is used, we compute a new leaf on the right tree. And this can actually be done in a way that you do not need to store two trees, but use the combined storage for both of them. And the last thing you do is compute upcoming leaves. So while these nodes are used, you do this next computation. So you distribute actually the computation of this leaf and the paths among all these computations. And this gives you, in the end, it simply gives you a much more reduced worst case runtime, because you split all these computations over all the steps and distribute them as far as possible. Actually, which I didn't describe here, we did some update for this, and in that case, you simply use, so you will not need all the updates you're given in all the steps for the basic BDS algorithm, and we simply use these unused updates to do all these computations in the higher trees. Okay, two more parts. The first one is on the security. So I'm not sure if you said this before. So XMSS has minimal security requirements, or that's something that we claim. And there are actually two interpretations for this. So the first one is what you've seen before. If you look at the current signature schemes, then we've got some intractability assumption and a collision-resistant hash function, which is either needed also for the security of the scheme, but in any case is needed to compress the message, so to deal with arbitrary message sizes. And this gives us a digital signature scheme. And as I showed you now, we can get rid of this second intractability assumption. So in practice, we reduce the assumptions to the one assumption required, namely the existence of a secure hash function. A different meaning is more computation theoretical. So it has been shown by Rompel, based on previous work of Nawa and Yang, that digital signatures, or the existence of digital signature schemes, is equivalent to the existence of a one-way function. So phrasing it the other way around, the existence of a one-way function is the necessary and the sufficient condition for the existence of a digital signature scheme. And now if we look at our security requirements, so we need two kinds of function families. One is the second pre-image resistant hash function family, and the second one is a pseudorandom function family. Then we get an existential unforgeable scheme under chosen message attacks, so for short, a secure signature scheme. And now the following existential relations hold. So as I told you, one-way functions exist if any digital signature scheme exists. Now, the proof by Rompel mainly consists of constructing a target collision-resistant hash function family from any one-way function family. And a target collision-resistant hash function family is actually a second pre-image-resistant hash function family. And thereby, as long as any digital signature scheme exists, also second pre-image-resistant hash function families exist. And we've got similar results for the pseudorandom function families. There's the Hill construction, which shows how to construct a pseudorandom generator out of any one-way function. And then there's the GGM construction, which some of you might know, which uses any length doubling pseudorandom generator to construct a pseudorandom function family. And so adding all this up together, we get that as long as any digital signature scheme exists, there also exists a secure instantiation of XMSS. And the security proof consists of a lot of building blocks. So on the one hand, we've got a proof that pseudorandom function families suffice for the security of the WinterNet scheme. Then if we get second pre-image resistant hash functions, we've got a proof that for these two conditions together, we get a secure XMSS tree construction. And then together with the PRF, we get the pseudorandom key generation involved and got a proof that XMSS is existential unforgeable. And we also got a proof that the scheme is forward secure. And we've got the same two proofs also for the case of tree chaining. And the last thing I want to show you, if I find the slides. Is this one. So, the scheme is implemented. Actually, there are currently some people starting a standardization. So there's a first draft for Merkle signatures in general already using the WinterNet scheme. And we're currently working towards standardizing the full XMSS scheme. And so in practice, we've got a bunch of choices. So on the one hand, we can implement these function families given any block cipher or secure hash function. So we can choose, especially after the SHA-3 competition, out of many possible candidates. And the basic construction principle is if we use a block cipher here, for example, AES, then for the PRF, we use the plain block cipher. And for the hash function, we use the Matthias Meyer-Oseas construction. So that's that part. So you feed the chaining variable to the key input, feed the message to the message input, and do a feed forward of the message. with an XOR in the end, and we iterate this one time in the Merkle-Damgård mode to get a compression function that compresses two n-bit strings to n-bit strings. If you get a secure hash function, then of course you get the hash function for free to build a pseudo-random function family. You can do a kind of simplified HMAC construction. So we do the basic HMAC, first padding the key to the whole block length of the hash function and appending the message. And so this actually only works for Merkle-Damgård constructions. In Merkle-Damgård constructions, now this first block gives us a new initialization vector, which is then kind of a pseudo-randomly generated key. And then we've got our pseudo-random function on the M. And in this case, we do not need the Merkle-Damgård strengthening or the more complicated padding things from HMAC, simply because we're dealing with length-preserving messages, with fixed-size inputs. So all these length extension attacks do not work in that case. So some numbers. We did the C implementation using OpenSSL for the implementation of the hash functions. And then you can see, for example, we can get down signatures to something below 2 kilobytes for bit security of 157. So far above what current schemes support. We can get very fast implementations if we use AES, especially here we use these new instructions set by Intel, which is now on all the modern Intel processors available. And then you can get down signing and verification time to 0.52 milliseconds and 0.07 milliseconds respectively, which is even faster than RSA for similar security. But of course, RSA got slightly smaller signatures and keys. However, RSA is broken when we got quantum computers, so don't have to care about this. remember the tree chaining. So we also did a smart card implementation. In that case, XMSS here denotes the single tree variant. XMSS plus is a two tree chaining variant. And here, for example, you can see the influence on the key generation time and on the signature times. On the one hand, we are using Wigginton's parameter 4 in both cases and a height of 16. So you can do 56,000 signatures with such a key pair. Afterwards, I'm quite sure that your smart card is broken. At least mine would be definitely broken. and we get down from 134 milliseconds to 106 milliseconds for the signature time. For comparison, RSA takes 190 milliseconds on this card. And the key generation time goes down from 925 seconds, which is, I think, if I remember correctly, something like 15 minutes to 5 seconds on the card. And for those of you who are a bit more into hardware, so as these schemes are stateful, we also have to deal with the problem considering the non-volatile memory. Because the memory on these cards wears out after a certain amount of write cycles. But even if we use key pairs with a height of 20, we only require 5 million write cycles. And for example, on this card, one sector wears out after something like 16.5 million write cycles. So we could do 3 key pairs in the same storage area before the storage actually breaks. That's it from my side. Do you have any questions?